Thank you very much. It's really an honor to be here, such a distinguished panel. I want to just reiterate, I'm speaking in my own capacity, not representing anyone else. Now, the gravity of the issue we're discussing here today, national security secrecy, really cannot be overstated. At stake, I would argue, differ with my colleagues, is the personal safety of all Americans. Osama bin Laden may be dead, but Islamic radicals remain determined to strike the United States. Abroad, many of our young men and women are at war, and in Afghanistan and other battlefields. And secrecy is often vital to the preservation of their lives. Now, to keep our country secure, our government inevitably generates a great many secrets of many different kinds. We can't publicize, among other things, all the intelligence methods by which we're tracking terrorists. We can't reveal the vulnerabilities of our bridges and tunnels and buildings. We have an absolute duty to keep secret things like the blueprints for nuclear weapons or the formulas for producing things like aerosolized anthrax. But equally at stake, of course, is the character of our democracy. We live in an open society, and secrecy is antithetical to the democratic idea. Secrecy can be used as a cover for corruption and wrongdoing. We depend upon a free press to provide us with information about what our government is doing in our name, including some of the things it's doing in secret. Indeed, much of what we read in the newspapers about foreign affairs is based upon reporting about state secrets. A study by the Senate Intelligence Committee counted 147 separate disclosures of classified information that made their way into the nation's top six newspapers in just 1 6-month period alone. So the regular publication of secrets is the way things are in the American system, and that's the way they ought to be. But even as we have a press that reports on secrets, and a press that we want to be reporting on secrets, it must do so under the rule of law. That is, the press, and I would certainly include an outfit like WikiLeaks as part of the press, must be vulnerable to prosecution when it violates the laws governing secrecy. Now, the First Amendment says that Congress shall pass no law abridging freedom of speech or of the press. And Judge Posner has pointed to all of the exceptions to that. We can't publish false advertising, or we can't, it's forbidden to yell fire in a crowded theater like this one. Now, Congress has also passed laws that punish the publication of state secrets, the publication. And it has done so for the very same reason that we're prohibited from yelling fire when there's no fire. It's speech that can get people killed. Thus, the Comint Act makes it a crime to publish classified information pertaining to communications intelligence. The Atomic Energy Act makes it a crime to publish classified information pertaining to the design of nuclear weapons. The Intelligence Identities Protection Act makes it a crime to disclose the identities of undercover CIA agents. Now, these laws are in obvious tension with the First Amendment, but no court has ever struck them down. They were passed because the American people, acting through their elected representatives, sought to protect themselves against anyone, including journalists, who would disclose government secrets to do us harm. Valid laws that would punish the press for publication of state secrets are on the books. Now, does the existence of such laws mean that journalists should be prosecuted every time they publish a state secret? Absolutely not. That would be foolish in the extreme. It's widely recognized, and I agree with my colleagues, that the US government uses the secrecy stamp promiscuously. It marks lots of things secret that shouldn't be. The issue is not whether the press should always be prosecuted for publishing secrets. In almost all cases, it should not be. I myself published classified information when I was an editor at Commentary magazine, and I would do so again. The real question before us is whether the press can be prosecuted when it publishes secrets that place the country in danger. That's the question raised by WikiLeaks. Such danger is not purely hypothetical. Not everyone out there with access to a printing press or to the internet is always going to behave responsibly. And there are no shortage of examples of real harm being done to our country through a disclosure publication of leaks. And during World War II, to take the famous case pertaining to this city, the Chicago Tribune, under the auspices of Colonel McCormick, published a story suggesting that the U.S. had broken Japanese naval codes. Now, if the Japanese had acted upon that story and changed their codes, the U.S. would have lost, we would have been deprived of a critical window into Japanese planning that would have cost thousands, if not tens of thousands, of American servicemen their lives. Back in 1973, a magazine called Counterspy began to publish the names of hundreds of CIA officers around the world. And in 1975, one of those officers, Richard Welch, CIA station chief in Greece, was assassinated by Greek terrorists just after he had been outed by Counterspy as the CIA station chief. In 2006, Judy's newspaper, The New York Times, chose to reveal the workings of a counterterrorism program that tracked the movement of Al-Qaeda funds. The program was lawful, operating under valid warrants, and the story caused one of our principal challenges of intelligence.